Best Irish music on irishradio.org with Jerry Byrne.
Irish Radio, I'm Jerry Byrne, and as this the pandemic and all the rest of it, I'm speaking to many of the great and the good talents of music in Ireland. And my next guest is a gentleman who needs no introduction to the world of music. In fact, not alone in Ireland, this man has quite literally toured the world as one half of the most successful duo ever to come out of Ireland. I'm delighted to say hello to the one and only Tony Allen of Foster and Allen. Tony, how are you?
I'm very good. How are you?
Not bad at all, Tony. Not bad at all. Listen, you've spent an absolute lifetime of incredible achievements in music, but you come originally from the back in the show band days.
I do, yeah. I started actually one of the first groups I ever worked in. Mick Foster was in it. It was a very, very local band where I come from in Mount Temple, which is outside Moat, near Athlone in the Midlands. And there was a parish, our club was, GAA club was called Colliery, and the parish next to us was called Maryland. And they were running a series of fundraisers in the local school in Drumraney. And the boys down there formed a three-piece band, and then Mick Foster joined the band, and then I joined the band, and we played together for a couple of years doing all the local halls around home, you know, every school and hall around the villages and that. And then we went our separate ways, and I went working with Kieran Kelly's band for a while, replaced Brendan Shine as Kieran's singer. And after that, then I joined the great Doc Carroll and the Night Runners for a few years. And it was with the Night Runners that when Doc left again and formed another band, we toured. Mick joined the band again then, Mick Foster. Mick and Tom was playing two saxophones, believe it or not, in the band. And we were in London on tour with the Night Runners, and we met a man called Paddy Callahan, who had the Loughborough Hotel in Brixton. And Paddy was taking over a pub in up near Kilburn called the Prince of Wales, just down at Kilburn Tube Station down there. And he asked us, would myself and Mick, would we do a week for him opening the pub with just the keyboards and accordion? And that basically was where Foster and Allen started in Kilburn, at Kilburn Tube Station. We did a week there, and we had a great week. And we said, when we went home, let's have a go at the pubs and clubs around Ireland with this two-piece. And that's where it started back in late 74, early 75.
Truly incredible. It was all kind of an accidental situation, but it for some reason it really, really clicked.
Well, Mick had the idea. Mick Foster had seen the Alexander Brothers, and he was amazed with them because they had just a keyboard and an accordion, you know, and that's how we started out. And we worked all over Ireland from 75 up to 70, up to 80, 81 or 82 until we did Top of the Pops. And it was after that we decided to add to the group. And we were doing the clubs and around, and every village in Ireland had a good pub that time, a good cabaret lounge, you know. And we were very lucky because we worked all over Ireland. And, you know, we worked during the summertime, we'd work 7 nights a week. And then, of course, we signed up with CMR Records, Donny Cassidy. And we'd recorded an album, it was an album at the time, an LP. And then we signed up with CMR Records. And then Donny had his own radio show on RT Radio. And that kind of lifted the whole thing, you know, to another level. And then when the Bunch of Time was released in the UK, of course, that changed everything, because then we were on Top of the Pops, and that gave us a whole new lease of life in the UK. And we started doing from doing the Irish centres in England to doing the concerts, and we've been doing them ever since. I'm afraid stuck with us over there. Then, of course, Maggie was released in Australia and went to number one in Australia and New Zealand, and that again then lifted the whole thing out there for us. And I Will Love You All My Life, the Charlie Lansbury song, that was released in South Africa and Canada, and that became a hit in those two places. So we finished up touring the world on those songs, you know. And then in 82, after Top of the Pops, we dropped the green suits, the leprechaun suits. We dropped them and started wearing dress suits. And we were joined on stage then by Ollie Kennedy and Desi Hines. So it was a four-piece then until the end of the 80s. And then we added Basil Hendricks to the group that time, and the late Frank Summers joined us on drums. And then, of course, later on, then Myra came on keyboards. And then Brian, who is our present guitar player, Brian joined us. sometime later. So it, you know, we've been very, very lucky to have toured the world, and we're still touring the world, which is good.
That is absolutely superb. I mean, it's been an astounding, it's been an absolute roller coaster, because you've mentioned some of the songs there, but I mean, some of these songs, I mean, have been absolutely phenomenal. You mentioned there, I Will Love You All My Life, A Bunch of Time, another one After All These Years, you mentioned there, Maggie, yeah. Old Flames, huge success.
Old Flames, yeah.
Massive, I mean.
Great songs.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, the you also had a lot of success with the Old Rustic Bridge by the Mill, Sweet Forget Me Not, also... Mick on lead vocal with The Blacksmith, which was absolutely huge.
Blacksmith is a great song. We still get requests on stage for The Blacksmith and The Black Sheep. There were two songs that Mick recorded, and they were hugely successful. They didn't. Well, The Blacksmith was the B-side of The Bunch of Time in Ireland, and it was a hugely popular song. Still is. We still get requests for both The Blacksmith and The Black Sheep when we go on stage. And then later on, we've recorded about, I'd say, over 900 songs over the years. And later on then, PJ Murray, when we were 40 years on the road, which is six years ago now, I think, yeah. And PJ Murray, who wrote We Owe It All to You, which was for the reply to the people saying that, you know, that that's what it was all about. It was because of them we lasted so long. And then he wrote Mrs. Brown's Boys for us as well. And those two songs have been huge, you know, really, really huge. And then, of course, we did the song with Nathan, which really worked very, very well as well, you know. So, we've had a lot of different things. You know, we did the Galway Girl with Shane Ward, which, of course, was a huge hit for us. Not a huge hit record sales-wise, but radio plays and all that. Like in the UK, it got a massive amount of plays.
Indeed. Now, the interesting thing, I spoke to Mick back a few months ago, and he was telling me the story of The Black Sheep, and how he didn't really want to record it and did not think it would work.
Well, I actually was driving home from Moorfan, even to Mount Tibor, where I live, and local, it was still pirate radio in Ireland at the time, and I must have been, I think Radio 3 was coming from Mullingar at that time, Midlands Radio. And Johnny Lockery was on the radio singing it. And Johnny did a lovely version of it, a very slow version. The late, great Johnny Lockery, who was... And I heard this song and I said, geez, that'd be a great song for Mick, you know. And so it was very slow. And I turned it for Mick and he didn't really like it that much. But we were doing a week in the Brame Rooms in Dublin, and we went back to Athlone. Chad Nicholson had a studio in Athlone that time. It was long before we opened our own studio. And we went back late one night after the Brame Rooms and spent the whole night in the studio in Athlone, and we changed it to an old-time waltz and recorded. And it was, at that time, it was all cassettes, because I remember well, we brought out a four-track cassette with The Black Sheep, and it sold like mad in Ireland. It was really, really good, you know. And it was a huge success, great song. But it is a great song. It's an old Hank Snow song. You know, it's a really, really good song.
Indeed, fantastic. You know, I just found it, unbelievable. That he didn't actually sort of think that this would work, and he really was not into it at all. He told me the story of that, you know, and how you got the song. Yeah, it was incredible. It really was. But of all those, I mean, like you had other songs. I mean, which you haven't mentioned there. I mean, there's just so many. As you say, there's probably about, you know, we're talking 900 or so. But there were other songs which were very successful for you. I got a lot of radio airplay. I mean, you recorded with Gloria Honeyford, the old classic True Love.
Yeah, True Love, yeah. Yeah, True Love, yeah.
You know, and other songs.
That was one of the first duets I ever did. Was and we didn't do one after that for a long time. That was back in the days when we were with McClurkin's record company in London. And there, with Gloria had an album with them at the time as well, and they suggested we do this song. It's really a lovely song. It came out very, very well.
Indeed. You know, well, other songs, I mean, 1988, you had a lot of success with a song called The Golden Years.
That's right, yeah. That was recorded as a company in Dublin were doing an ad for the Bank of Ireland or something like that. But they had introduced this thing in the bank where they were doing something for senior citizens in the bank, you know, and somebody wrote this song called The Golden Years for them. And it came out, it was a No, it wasn't, was a hit record, but it was got a huge lot of radio plays and was a very, very, very popular song at the time.
Indeed. It's been astounding. So it all came, you're the same as everybody else, Tony. It all came to a crushing stop back in March. Your last concert, I believe, was in January of 2020.
Our last concert, I think, was in Kilkenny at the end of January. Well, every Christmas we do a tour of Ireland. We start the night after Boxing Night, and we sort of run right through to the end of January, working, not every night, but, you know, we do about maybe 18 or 20 dates. And the last night was in, I think it was in Kilkenny last year, and we came home, and Derek Rines had asked me to do a few shows with him as a guest, and I did a few with him, I think, just to solo spot. I know Olivia Douglas was on the show as well, and I did Wexford and Killarney and Limerick with them, and had finished those shows, and the next thing then this virus broke out and we were all off the road then, and we've been off the road ever since, which is, I suppose, it's a year and a couple of months now, and it doesn't look like we're going to be back. Well, we won't be, Fawcett and Allen won't be back definitely about Christmas time this year, you know.
Indeed, yes, I can imagine. Because, I mean, all of your, all of your work, as you were saying there, it's all concerts. I mean, it's all sort of theatres and hotels.
Yeah, it is all theatres and hotels, which is very, very easy to work in, and they're great. But then when it comes to getting people into theatres from here on, it could be a bit of a problem. You know, we have to convince them all that it's safe to come back. But we're already working on we have an album finished. We have it finished now for all the reunion. We had it finished for last Christmas and it didn't come out. It's ready to rock and roll, as the fella says.
Okay.
And this year, I'm in 46 years with Fawcett and Allen. I've never recorded, Mick has recorded a few albums, and he's all of traditional music and stuff like that. And I've never done an album of my own. So I'm hoping to get it in the studio in the next couple of months to do an album, just a Tony Allen album, and see how that goes, just for something different, you know.
Indeed. Why not? Is the new album, Tony? Is it kind of typical Fawcett and Allen, or are there any new tracks on it?
It's actually more of the old type Fawcett and Allen. There's a lot of sort of older Irishy type songs, lively songs, you know. And there's a few new songs. There's a great new song that's written by Derek Ryan and Ray McLaughlin, his keyboard player. It's a song called The Good Old Days When Times Were Bad, and they've just finished it. When I was on to Derek about writing a song, and I went up to Cookstown to see them one night, and they were on stage working on something, and I said, "What are you at, boys?" He said, "All right." Derek says, we're finishing that song for you here." He says, "I said that's great." He says, "It'll be great when you go." We were just going to Australia. He says, "It'll be great when you go to Australia." I says, "Yeah, go to Australia, the good old days." I said, "You know," and he says, "That's the name of the song." That's the song they were writing. It's called The Good Old Days. That's great. So I was talking to him then one night when I was touring. He said, "How's the song coming on?" I said, "It's really, really shaping up good." I said, "But I said, you know what I'd really put the finishing touches to it?" And he says, "Well," I said, "if you came in and did the duet with us, honestly." He says, "No problem." So he came down to the studio and we did a duet of it, and we have a video done for it. So it's ready to go whenever things lift a bit, you know. But the album will be quite good. I think we're doing a few standards like "We'll Meet Again" and songs like that, you know. And in fact, that could end up that could be the name of the album, because when we come back on the road, it'll be nice to say that people, you know, come out and see us, or "We'll Meet Again," that type of thing, you know. So we could even end up calling the tour that at Christmas. A lot of old standards and stuff like that. But it'll be a very Fawcett and Allen type album.
Right, that's excellent. It's Derek Ryan, I'll have to say, is a phenomenal songwriter.
He's unbelievable. He's credit, you know, and he's as good a songwriter as we've ever had in this country, you know. You know, we've had some great ones like Liam Riley and Phil Coulter and Kevin Sheehan, people, but he's up there with them. You know, he can write Anthony once. He's a born songwriter. You know, he's a natural.
Indeed.
Very, very much a natural, yeah.
Indeed. I mean, he's written so many songs, which he has never recorded himself. And
he's written loads of songs, yeah.
So many of them. You know, it's great to know that you've still got new material coming out and new recordings. I mean, in all of that over the years, you actually recorded and released two Christmas albums as well.
Well, we did the sort of an album and a half, and it came out originally way back in the, I'm kind of saying it was the, actually the first album we ever did in our own studio in Moss in the late '80s was a Christmas album, and then we added, it came out, we released it years later, and we added some more songs to it, you know. But we haven't done the trouble with Christmas albums is there's so many Christmas standards, and that's it, you know. Now, in fairness to Derek, he did a very good Christmas album himself last Christmas, and I think he wrote a few new songs for it. But we might do something like that again, you know, later on, maybe when we get back on the road again.
Indeed. So, is it still as enjoyable as it always was doing the touring?
Well, I absolutely love it, and I'm not too sure that Mick is that mad about being on the road much. This stage, he keeps saying he likes to slow down a bit, you know, and that's another reason why I wanted to do an album. I sort of do something a little bit different from Fawcett and Allen, so maybe at some stage I could go out on the road and do a different type of concert, you know. But at the moment, in Christmas and the New Year, it'll be pretty much Fawcett and Allen, I'd say, you know. Let's see what happens. I really love what I do. I love being on the road. I love the traveling, and I love the live concerts. There's nothing like a live concert.
Indeed. And it's also another thing, which is it's also magic, and so many singers say they miss it, is meeting the people.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And that'll be the big thing now when we come back, because you probably won't get to go out and meet people after a show. It'll be probably too dangerous for a while anyway, you know, but we'll see how it goes, you know. But it'd be a terrible miss not to be able to go out and say hello to people, you know, because they're the ones that make it all worthwhile, whether we like it or not. That's the way it goes, you know. We make the music, fellas like yourself play it, and then the people come in and listen to it, and that's how it works.
Indeed. So, you've done, I know, a little in the past, but do you do much work with your wife Trina Allen, who's also a fantastic vocalist?
Trina works with Daniel all the time, of course, and not a lot. No, she did an album, and I did a few tracks on. In fact, when I do the album, my own album, I'll definitely bring her along to sing a few songs with me. But we don't do any work together as such. She works with Daniel all the time. And I think because we're on the road, Daniel is normally on the road as well. So it works fine for us, you know. We don't want to be... if she came with me, then she'd have to turn down the Ets with Daniel O'Donnell, and that wouldn't be very fair.
Well, indeed, yes. She's, Trina has been with Daniel for many, many years. She's also done a lot of...
I think she's the longest serving member of herself, you know, at this stage, yeah.
Indeed. And she's also done a lot of, collaborations and recordings with others. She's done a couple of fantastic recordings with Billy McFarland.
She did. They were great songs, actually, yeah. Absolutely brilliant, yeah.
Indeed.
Al, Billy's an old trooper, you know. He's great. He's a lovely man, Billy, and Nan, the wife. They're absolutely lovely people.
Indeed.
And I don't know if you know Billy personally, but he's the funniest man you could meet on the road, Billy.
Yes, indeed.
He's a great character, yeah. He's done some of the thousands over the years as well, yeah.
Indeed, great character, no doubt about it. And I must say it's strange times, Tony. You're sort of itching to get going whenever it's safe to do so again. But you're still keeping the interest in music.
Oh, absolutely, still, yeah, yeah. We did a few things here now on the 15th of May. I've got to record the. James McGarity and few of the boys have the, I think it's called On the Couch or something like that, Music from the Couch, and that goes out on online. They stream that show, and I think Gary Gamble does it with them, and I'm doing a few songs on that, and I don't know when it's going out. It's been recorded on the 15th of May with Jared Donan, and a few things like that, you know. And before the lockdown, I did a lot of bits and pieces up here with people like Sean Mullis and people like that, you know. And of course, I did a few tracks with Owen Mack as well. I did a song with Owen, Farside Banks of Jordan, which worked very, very well for us.
Indeed so, it did, yes. I've played it many, many times. It's taken from Owen's gospel album, and I'll have to say it is a song which has proven very, very popular.
Yeah, we got on great with that. It works very, very well. I did a couple of stream shows with him as well. He did the gospel album, and he did a, I think he's doing a Christmas stream show as well. So, yeah, he's going to be very, very big in the music business.
Indeed so. Indeed so. Huge reaction.
I think he's going to be the biggest thing in the next 5 or 6 years. He'll just be massive.
Yes. Yes. Very, very, very talented. Very talented gentleman indeed. And you know,
he's only 18 as well, which is a huge help, you know.
Indeed, indeed, definitely, definitely is. Tony, listen, it's been fascinating catching up with you. I'm delighted to see that you're still as enthusiastic as you were all those years ago.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And I'm looking forward now to our own album, and I'm looking forward to starting to work on my own album as well. You know, I'd love to take that on the road for on tour as well. You know, sometime just put a slightly different type show on the road just for a once-off trip, something like that, you know.
Indeed, that definitely sounds good. Tony, listen, fantastic to chat to you, fantastic to catch up with you. Listen to yourself and your lady wife, Trina. Stay safe and stay well, and listen, I'm looking forward to catching you on stage as soon as it's safe to do so.
Yes, absolutely. You look after yourself and take it easy, and the same to all your listeners, you know. Thank you all for being there. You're all listening, which is a good thing, you know.